Baby, you understand me now. If sometimes you see that I'm mad, don't you know no one alive can always be an angel? When everything goes wrong, you see some bad. But I'm just a soul whose intentions are good. Oh Lord, please don't let me be misunderstood.
Growing up with him in Brookfield, it was cool because we were just all very proud of where we were raised. We just loved living in East Oakland, and it's a place where there's a lot of history, a lot of excitement, a lot of pride, you know, also a lot of violence and things like that. And so that kind of just also was a way of life. So we just learned to live in that space. And so unfortunately, some friends were like violent, but they were just friends, you know. We just didn't engage in that same way. That's one thing that I've always known about Hector, is that he's like hella thoughtful and very caring about people. Where I actually chose him to be my daughter's godfather. And so out of all the people that I know in my life, of all the people that I could have chose, I chose Hector because he was so caring, so thoughtful, so like strong, so strong-minded. I can always tell he was very focused. And so that's why I chose him as a godfather, so that he could be there for my daughter if I'm not there.
I met Hector the summer before my senior year of high school, and right away his personality and the way he carried himself really stood out. One of the things that he did, which I thought was, you know, unlike anything that any your typical teenage boy would do, is that, you know, he actually wanted to get permission from my parents to date me. You know, that itself, you know, really got him brownie points from my parents, especially my mom, who, you know, always wanted the best for me. Hector and I were really inseparable. You know, we did everything together. You know, we really enjoyed each other's company, always going to the movies and going out to dinner and these games and, you know, warrior games. And, you know, we shared a lot in common that all made it easier for me to actually fall in love with him.
It was February 28th when I got arrested. I had just gotten out of work. I decided to mow my front lawn. So I was cutting my grass, and out of nowhere, like a million police came out of nowhere. They were in front of my house. And I was just like, what the hell's happening? Like, who are they here for or what, you know? But then they got out and started walking towards me. At the time, I had a black gate in the front of my house. I stepped outside, and as soon as I did, they put handcuffs on me. And when that happened, I was just like, what the f***? Like, what's happening? Like, why? Why are you guys doing this? And they said, no, we can't talk about it right now. I'm like, why not? You guys have handcuffs on my hands. Like, I need to know why you guys are arresting me. You guys, this is not fair.
It was February 28th, 2011.
I got a call from my mom, and she was tripping that the cops were there, and I was like trying to calm her down. And I never known Hector to do anything, you know, that'll get him, you know, mixed up with cops or whatever. And so when she said that, I was like, oh, it's probably just a big mix up. Don't worry about it, Mom. Everything's gonna be okay.
Things really took a turn for the worse. When I got there, you know, it was definitely a sight that I did not want to see.
We went to downtown headquarters, and they didn't start interviewing me till like 3 in the morning. So I'm like, my mind has been racing all this time. Like, what the hell is happening? Like, why don't they come see me? Like, come on, let's get this straightened out. I have to work tomorrow. Like, you know, I'm going to be hella tired. Like, I'm just like, we need to resolve this now. So when they did finally come in, it was a male and a female. And they came in like it was nothing. Like, they came in like super cool and suave, like, you know, trying to be my friend, asking me questions and stuff, like, hey, what's up, like, you know, trying to get on my good side. And I was answering all their questions at first, because they just were asking me personal questions, like what I did, you know, about my family and stuff, about who I knew and if I knew this person and if I knew that person, if this person was related to me, are these people my friends? And I'm like, where is this leading to? Like, you know, like, what's happening? Then they started saying, yeah, a lot of people are saying that they identified you as being the shooter, that you killed somebody. And I'm like, I swear my heart sank. So I'm like, damn, this is more serious than I thought. So I told them, you know what, I need to talk to a lawyer. And they're like, are you sure? Like, you know, do you want to go that route? I'm like, yeah, I do. And after that, they took me into booking.
He's gonna get taken away, and we were like, what the hell? And so we were all very concerned and scared. And so then we heard about the charges, and
I was actually accused of a crime that he did not commit.
So they eventually did take me to jail. I didn't know what to expect, because I've never been in jail before. And, you know, I was just, my mind was racing. They escort me to the housing units, and, you know, it's just a whole bunch of criminals there, and they looking all tough and, you know, dangerous, and I'm just like, what the fuck, I'm not supposed to be here, like, you know. But they send me into my room, and it's like a little small room, like, you know, arm span length, you know.
One is the loneliest number that you'll ever do. Two can be as bad as one. It's the loneliest number since the number one.
I wasn't even eating. Like, everybody was telling me, like, you know, oh, you're in here for murder, like, you're gonna be here for a long time, like, years. And I was just like, nah, hell no, not me, hell no. They're like, yeah, like, it takes years, you know, because you're going back and forth to court. But I was like, no, not me, like, I'm innocent, like, you know, so it's different with me. But it eventually took almost close to 2 years for everything to settle out. But in the meantime, I just kind of made my own program, like, you know, I just kept my mind busy. If I wasn't reading books, I was doing Sudoku, I was playing chess, I was just kept my mind busy. Like,
visits at the county jail were always bittersweet. You know, I was always excited and counted the days and hours even to go and see him. But they always seemed to go by so fast. You know, I think they were about half an hour long, and it was just not enough. Never, never enough. I was a character witness at his trial, and that was one of the hardest things that I've ever had to do. I had to sit in a room where on one side you have loved ones that wanted him free and home as soon as possible, and the other half looked at him as a monster and wanted him to spend the rest of his life in jail. But thankfully, we had one of the best lawyers defending him. You know, Yolanda Huang was really an angel sent from heaven.